There are two major beta-oxidation defects. The first defect, called primary carnitine deficiency. In this condition, the carnitine level in the body is extremely low, and this disrupts the function of carnitine shuttle. Without carnitine, fatty acids cannot be transported from the cytoplasm into the mitochondrial matrix. Thereby, fatty acids accumulate in the cell or cytosol. And it's long-chain fatty acids because they are already uptaken by the cell, so they are intact. So the first signature feature of primary carnitine deficiency is accumulation of long-chain fatty acids in the cell or cytosol. And these long-chain fatty acids must be stored somewhere. And there is no better storage form than triacylglycerols, because triacylglycerols are totally hydrophobic. They do not attract water, and exactly this feature makes them so compact substances to store. So long-chain fatty acids in the cell or cytosol bind to glycerol with formation of triacylglycerols. So on muscle biopsies, the signature feature of carnitine deficiency is elevated triacylglycerols level and a very low carnitine level. Without fatty acids transportation, mitochondria does not have any fatty acids to oxidize at all. So mitochondria cannot produce acetyl-CoA, and without acetyl-CoA, Krebs cycle does not work, and this results in severe decrease in energy production. So tissues are in severe energy depletion state, and the most sensitive to severe energy deficiency are muscle tissue and liver tissue. Liver tissue without sufficient amount of ATP molecules cannot produce glucose, so energy deficiency disrupts gluconeogenesis, and this results in severe hypoglycemia. And usually, severe hypoglycemic state triggers increase in production of ketone bodies by liver tissue, which is a totally normal compensatory response. But without acetyl-CoA, liver tissue cannot produce ketone bodies, so this results in low ketone bodies level in the blood. So mitochondria cannot compensate low blood glucose level by production of ketone bodies, and this results in hyperketotic hypoglycemia, which is the signature feature of all beta-oxidation defects. Carnitine deficiency affects myocardial tissue. In case of cardiac muscle, energy depletion causes development of dilated cardiomyopathy at a very young age. But the major clinical manifestations are related to skeletal muscles. Because skeletal muscles does not have enough energy during regular physical activity, child experience muscle weakness, hypotonia and muscle aches. But if only a child starts to do some intensive physical activity, the clinical picture becomes much more severe. The concept is that muscle tissue is in energy depleted state, and physical activity requires a lot of energy. In addition to this, liver tissue cannot provide any support because it cannot produce no glucose nor ketone bodies. And this disbalance between high energy demands and low energy production in skeletal muscle tissue results in severe ischemia in muscle tissue that leads to rhabdomyolysis. Destruction of skeletal muscle cells results in release of myoglobin that then appears in the urine, a condition known as myoglobinuria. And because myoglobin is toxic for renal canaliculi, at some point this causes acute renal failure. Also, with destruction of muscle cells, creatinine kinase released into the circulation, so creatinine kinase level becomes significantly elevated. The second beta-oxidation defect to know is medium-chain acyl-CoA dehydrogenase deficiency. It's the most common beta-oxidation defect. In contrast to carnitine deficiency, mitochondria is able to uptake long-chain fatty acids and oxidize them. But because medium-chain acyl-CoA dehydrogenase is deficient, fatty acids can be oxidized only to a medium chain. So tissue are in energy deficient state. Liver tissue does not have enough energy to provide gluconeogenesis, so this causes hypoglycemia. And in case of prolonged fasting, mitochondria begin massive uptake of fatty acids that degrade only to a medium chain. This results in production of only minimal amount of acetyl-CoA, still insufficient to produce sufficient amount of ketone bodies. Thereby, patients with medium-chain acyl-CoA dehydrogenase deficiency also have hyperketotic hypoglycemia. Also, because fatty acids can be degraded only to a medium chain, this results in accumulation of medium-chain fatty acids initially inside the mitochondrial matrix, then inside the cell, and finally in the blood. So the signature feature of medium-chain acyl-CoA dehydrogenase deficiency is accumulation of medium-chain acyl-carnitines in the tissues and in the blood. But as we see, carnitine shuttle with long-chain acyl-CoA dehydrogenases are working properly. Thereby, fatty acids are transported to mitochondrial matrix and some energy at least produced. And in case if child has proper diet, this disorder can be even asymptomatic, so medium-chain acyl-CoA dehydrogenase deficiency has milder presentation. but if only a significant fasting period occurs, child suddenly decompensate. And the reason is that even in normal condition, children have limited glucose reserves and begin to use ketone bodies after 8 to 10 hours of fasting. So to provide ketone bodies production, mitochondria begin massive uptake of long-chain fatty acids that because of medium-chain acyl-CoA dehydrogenase deficiency can be degraded only to a medium chain. This causes massive accumulation of medium-chain fatty acids inside the mitochondria, and some portion of accumulated fatty acids inside mitochondria undergo omega-oxidation that results in production of decarboxylic acids. And high amount of decarboxylic acids together with accumulated medium-chain fatty acids cause severe mitochondrial dysfunction. The concept here is that accumulated in mitochondrial matrix decarboxylic acid and medium-chain fatty acids induce mitochondrial permeability transition that results in uncoupling of oxidative phosphorylation, that results in decrease in energy production, and also MPT-induced severe oxidative stress. The most pronounced damage occurs to a liver tissue, basically it's the same mechanism of liver injury that occurs in Reye syndrome, and moreover, it causes Reye-like symptoms. First of all, it causes liver injury that manifests as mild hepatomegaly, and liver tissue in severe energy deficient state becomes less functionally capable, that's why the second feature is hepatic dysfunction. And because of hepatic dysfunction, liver ability to extract ammonia from the blood decreases, and this causes increase in blood ammonia level that causes development of acute non-inflammatory hepatoencephalopathy that causes cerebral edema that leads to increase in intracranial pressure. And increase in intracranial pressure causes neurological symptoms as headaches and vomiting. Also, with progressive increase in intracranial pressure, more severe neurological symptoms appear as confusion, coma, and seizures. And also, increased intracranial pressure causes compression of brainstem that causes respiratory dysfunction that can lead to a sudden death. In order to prevent this, we have to prevent fat catabolism, so child must avoid prolonged fasting, and if such symptoms appear, promptly intravenous glucose infusions must be prescribed.